Thank you for joining us today for our conversation. My name is Gerardo Chavez, president of the Student Senate for California Community Colleges, or simply known as the SSCCC. The SSCCC represents 2.1 million students in the California Community College system. Today, we have the honor to have a discussion about one of the most important aspects of higher education, which is financial aid. Joining us today is the executive director of the California Student Aid Commission, Marlene Garcia. Marlene Garcia has 25 years of experience working on educational policy issues for a variety of government and higher education institutions. She previously served more than 6 years as a national leader in Apple Inc.'s educational strategic initiative groups, also served as the vice chancellor of governmental relations for the California Community College system, deputy state policy director for the CSU system, and senior policy consultant in the Senate Education Committee. Thank you so much, Marlene, for joining us today.
Thank you, Gerardo, for having me. I'm really honored to be able to speak to you and your fellow students in the community college system. I was a community college student myself. I wasn't eligible for a four-year institution upon graduating from high school, but the community colleges offered me such an amazing opportunity, and I was able to transfer to get my baccalaureate degree from UCLA and then on to a master's degree from Claremont Graduate School. So I am eternally grateful to the California Community Colleges for giving me the start I needed. And also, you know, I'm really grateful to have the opportunity to lead the California Student Aid Commission. I was also a CalGrant student and a Pell Grant student. So it's my career has come full circle for me to be able to serve students like myself who just need that support and encouragement and can go on to thrive in their college education and then, you know, onward into the work world. The California Student Aid Commission serves about 457,000, almost a half a million students every single year. We are the largest state financial aid program in the country. We're funded at $3.8 billion that we give in aid to students. And so it's an extremely generous program that California runs and critical for so many students like myself and probably many of you who are watching this. So it is a real honor and privilege to oversee how we implement the CalGrant program and a variety of other specialized programs that are coming online to help specific student populations with their needs. The question was, how do we move forward in ensuring that the CalGrant program serves the students that it's intended to serve? Well, the CalGrant program was designed 60 years ago at a time when California was a very different place. And over the years, the state has changed demographically, economically, and so have the needs of our college students. So we have really taken steps in this past couple of years to redesign the CalGrant program to reflect the needs of today's students. And today's students are not necessarily your traditional college students who go straight from high school into a four-year institution or even a two-year institution. The average age of students attending college is in the neighborhood of 27 years old. And so what we want to do is we want to ensure that we have a system that is designed to meet the needs, to meet you where you're at. And not all the students come from the same place. So that's been one of the basic principles of our CalGrant reform and modernization effort.
Thank you so much for providing that insight. And I completely agree with you that our community college system demographic has changed dramatically. And we're seeing a shift from the traditional students coming from high school and enrolling to community college. Now we start seeing more student parents, students who are currently formerly incarcerated enter our community college system. For the students who are not necessarily aware of, what is the difference between Pell Grant and CalGrant?
So that's a really good question. So Pell Grants are grants, they're not loans that you don't have to pay back, and they're funded by the federal government. And it's basically a straight grant that goes directly to the student to support basic needs, basic living expenses. So you can use it to cover your rent, cover your food, cover your transportation, whatever your needs are to attend college. A Cal Grant, by and large, is a state-funded grant, but by and large, pays for your tuition. And it pays your tuition in full if you're going to one of the four-year public institutions. It pays about $9,800 if you're going to a private institution, a nonprofit private institution. For community colleges, because fees are already waived, for the most part, from the College Promise, it pays an access award of $1,648. And that's similar to the Pell Grant in that it's straight grant award that you receive to pay for your basic living expenses, not associated with the tuition. And so those are the funds that, there's been a lot of conversation around lately at the federal level, a lot of the advocacy to increase the Pell Grant, which was increased by about $500, but also to increase the CalGrant access award to help cover basic living expenses. Because as we all know, living in California is very expensive and food and housing are very expensive. Mm-hmm. So those are the primary differences, and they really are designed to work hand in hand.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much. And speaking about living in California and how expensive it is now in 2022 and the recent report that came out about the spike in inflation. We know that the governor last year increased financial aid in the state budget. What did that expansion look like in the state budget?
Yeah, I'm really glad you asked about that, because last year the legislature and the governor took a historic action in increasing CalGrant access to community college students. And what was done is what was adopted was an entitlement program for all community college students who have need and who meet baseline eligibility requirements. So in the past, there were some restrictions that said if you applied for a Cal Grant within a year after graduating from high school, and if you had need, you would get an entitlement. But if you were more than a year out of high school, you were put into what was a competitive pool. And the competitive pool only offered 44,000 competitive Cal Grant awards. And that program was so oversubscribed that only 1 in 8 eligible students actually got an award. So now, all students who meet the criteria, irrespective of how long they've been out of high school, are eligible for the competitive award. And we reprocessed the awards last fall, and we were able to add 110,000 more awards, distribute 110,000 more awards to community college students, to students who otherwise would not have received that competitive award. So we were really excited about that change. Unfortunately, the competitive program still exists for four-year institutions. So we're still moving forward and saying that we need CalGrant reform, that we need to finish the job. And there are a number of other barriers that we're looking to address through the what remains of CalGrant reform.
Speaking about CalGrant reform, the state government made amazing strides in expanding access for CalGrant, but what barriers should we aim to eliminate in the current financial aid system? And what has yet to be done?
Thank you for asking that question. We are so grateful to the governor and the legislature for adopting the historic new investments in CalGrant expansion for community colleges last summer in the State Budget Act. But we're still moving forward and pushing for removing the remaining equity barriers in CalGrant reform or CalGrant modernization. And these are what remains. For community college students, we'd like to eliminate the GPA. So for those students who've been out of high school for 10 years, we really believe that the GPA is not that relevant and it's extremely difficult for them to get. So that's a real barrier for for many, many adult learners. The second is it contains a growth index. So every year your access award would grow by a set growth index. The third area is to completely eliminate the competitive awards for four-year institutions. And then the fourth area is to streamline the program into the CalGrant 2 for community college students with one set of eligibility requirements so that students know in advance what they're required to do and how much money they get, and then streamline the four-year side to CalGrant 4 and do the same thing for them so that they understand what the eligibility requirements are and what they get. That's really a key to being able to help empower students and families plan for their college education so that they can make the best choices for themselves. And then the last piece of CalGrant reform is to align to the federal government changes that you're aware of with the FAFSA changes, the Pell Grant changes. And so we would need to align to the feds. And so we'd have a streamlined, seamless system.
Mm-hmm. Now that you highlighted the call to action in modernizing our CalGrant system, what can the state government do to further equity in our financial aid system?
I think it's really important. I mean, I'm going to talk about affordability because that's probably one of the primary equity barriers for first generation students, students from low income backgrounds. And, you know, at the end of the day, there are a lot of students out there who think they can't afford college, and they don't know that there are these programs out there to help them pay for college. For example, for community college students and four-year institution students, if you are eligible for a Cal Grant, California grant, and you have dependents, you get $6,000, not $1,648 annually for your access award. A lot of students don't know that. Foster youth, same thing for them. They get the $6,000, not just the $1,648. And so we really need to let students know that there are a lot of options for them to pay for college. And we really want to be part of empowering communities to understand that this is an opportunity for them, that this can change their trajectory in life and can help, you know, further advanced generations in their communities to also be able to take advantage of a changing workplace and a more automated workplace. So I really think equity, as you know, at least the lens that I look at, is from an affordability standpoint, and that we do everything we can to help students. Now, one more point, California is one of only 12 states in the country that offers state financial aid to undocumented students. And I feel very strongly that we get the word out and let students know that while they're not eligible for federal financial aid, they are eligible for CalGrant aid and California aid. And so we're really doing everything we can to let those students know that there is financial aid available to you, and that we as a state care about investing in every student to change their, to break the cycle of poverty through education and to aspire to the life they deserve. And so that to me is the ultimate in breaking down those equity barriers.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for highlighting that California is one of the 12 states in the country that provide financial aid, state financial aid to our undocumented students, which, you know, we're leading in the nation to be able to provide equity to all students regardless of documentation. This is just a bonus question talking about meeting students where they are. If a student is not aware of financial aid, and if they do and they start thinking that they are not eligible for financial aid, which the reality is that there is a stigma that there's made assumptions that students are not eligible and therefore don't apply. How would you respond to that?
Well, first of all, there's been a lot of research done in this area. And unfortunately, some of the lowest income families don't believe that they're eligible for financial aid, where some of the higher income families do think that they can afford to pay college and that they are that they do have access to financial aid. So we really need to turn that around. And one of the exciting changes that our state has taken in adopting this new requirement that every student in California starting this fall will be required to complete a FAFSA or a California Dream Act application. And once you complete that application, it gets processed. And within, you know, 72 hours, the student finds out if they're eligible. And they find out that, oh my gosh, I get $6,000 from the federal Pell Grant, or I get a Cal Grant of $12,000 if I'm going to UC, or, you know, $5,700 if I'm going to CSU. And it's really important to empower students and communities with that information. In addition, we're really doing everything we can to expand our Cash for College workshops, which are workshops that help students and families complete the applications. And also we're promoting financial aid on social media so that students and families have the information they need and that they know that these programs are designed for them and that if they're struggling financially, there is a program available to them. So our job is constantly to figure out how to get the word out and meet communities where they are. And, you know, partnering with organizations like yourselves and other community-based organizations who have trusted relationships in your communities to say, yes, this is real. This isn't a scam. Free money for college, that's not a scam. If it's coming from the California Student Aid Commission, it's real. So we really can't do it alone. We have to work hand in glove with all of our partners up and down the state.
Mm-hmm. And for the students who are watching, do you mind providing this information to them on where they can apply for financial aid?
Absolutely. You can go to our website, www.csac.ca.gov, and you'll see right on the landing page, applying for a FAFSA, applying for a California Dream Act. You can also register for a Cash for College workshop. And I should note, especially because you all are community college students, one of the biggest challenges is that community college students have access to the College Promise Grant and your fees are waived. A lot of times they don't understand there's more grant money available to you and they don't apply for the FAFSA or the California Dream Act. If you are eligible for the FAFSA and you get the College Promise Grant, that opens up $6,000 from federal Pell Grant that you can have access to, plus the additional $1,600 or the $6,000, depending on your circumstance, from the state. So we're launching a big campaign to get community college students who are already enrolled to apply for financial aid, because our data shows that 50% of the College Promise students don't apply for FAFSA. So even though you're enrolled, you've got, please take the time to apply now. And if you're a renewal student, you have until June to apply. If you're a first-time student and you want access to those of you, especially who are transferring to a four-year institution, apply by March 2nd. That's the deadline for four-year institution students. But for community college students, you have until September 2nd to apply. So I urge all of you to apply if you haven't applied for financial aid yet.
Thank you so much for that information. Marlene, last question. This is a call to action for the Student Senate. What can we do, the Student Senate, to modernize CalGrant and ensure financial aid is equitable for all of our California Community College students? What is your advice?
Thank you so much, Gerardo, for that question. And the CCC is been a critical partner. As a matter of fact, the students are co-sponsoring the new CalGrant reform legislation, which is being introduced now in the legislature. But what we also know that this is ultimately going to get addressed in the budget. So I would say mobilize your students up and down the state, get them involved, get them active, talking to their local legislators to support completing the CalGrant reform efforts. And the budget process is going to be critical. Next week, we have the first Senate hearing on financial aid expansion. I would encourage you to send your representatives to testify at that hearing. And then also, I think in early March will be the assembly hearing on the Senate budget side, on the assembly budget side. And I would encourage you to participate and make your voices heard, because I believe that those who are closest to the problem are the ones who should solve it. And you have the agency, you have the street cred, you're living it right now. So your voices matter. And I'm really grateful that all three of the public higher ed segment student organizations have agreed to co-sponsor the legislation with the Student Aid Commission under the Fixed Financial Aid hashtag. And I think that we have a window right now. We still have a surplus, and that it's really important to really speak from a unified voice. I think I would take direction also from, you know, some of the political advisors who are talking about focusing on the budget once it gets into the budget, that's going to be important, and that, you know, but continuing your advocacy. You guys were amazing last year.
Thank you. And for the students who are watching, if you have it in you to participate in a movement to modernize a CalGrant, the SSCCC is currently collecting testimonies of our students who are recipients of CalGrant. And if you're not a recipient of CalGrant, then we still want to hear your story, so that way we're able to remind folks in the Capitol on the importance of expanding financial aid eligibility and accessibility. Thank you so much, Marlene, for sitting down with us to have a conversation on the importance of reforming our CalGrant system and also providing valuable information for our students to empower themselves to get to know our financial aid system.
Thank you so much for the opportunity, Gerardo, and thank you for those really thoughtful questions.
Thank you. And for those of you joining, please visit our website, www.sSCCC.org, for more information on how to get involved with the advocacy and expanding eligibility and expanding accessibility for financial aid for all of our students. Thank you for joining us.